Wow, full house, full house. I like this. Good evening, and thank you all for joining me today for the second annual Central Falls celebration of the life of Martin Luther King Jr. I'm so honored to be celebrating the life of such an inspirational man alongside city residents and honorable individuals joining us today. I'd like to recognize a few of our honored guests before we begin today's program. Jim Vincent of the NAACP, a good friend. We also have these engaged young leaders who have worked hard on preparing performances for us here from Tall University, Central Falls High School, Blackstone Valley Prep, here to perform the rendition of the drum of Major's Instinct. Is my friend Joe Wilson Jr. Please give him a round of applause. Bernier Carter and Mario Bueno from Progreso Latino are here to kick off the winter food drive. I also want to recognize all my staff, Director of Parks and Recs, Joshua Giraldo, Director of Planning, Steve Larrick, Grant Writer, Derek Calamati, Colonel James Mendonca, Chief Bradley, Mayor McKee, Ernie Almonte, Councilman Murray, Jeremy Chepeta, and our councilwoman, Ms. Johnson, Ms. Steinel Siegel, and Ann Ratcliffe. Thank you so much for being here today. I'm so happy to be celebrating the life of Martin Luther King Jr. here in City Hall. Dr. King was an exceptional leader who exemplified true passion working towards equal opportunity for all individuals, regardless of their race or socioeconomic background. I want this message to be heard throughout every street in the city. Some people might say Central Falls has had a dark past, but I know, like Dr. King said on April 3rd in 1968, only when it's dark enough can you see the stars, and I see the stars every night. Thank you all for being here, and I'd like to introduce our next speaker, NAACP President Jim Vincent. Sorry.
Well, first of all, I'd like to thank the mayor. Mayor Diossa, I think you have one of the finest mayors in the state of Rhode Island, bar none. I think so highly of this young man. I know that before he became mayor, was with the College Crusade. I am on that board of directors, so I know him. I've known him for a while, and we at the NAACP Province Branch think so much of him that when we had our gala on November 1st, we made him one of our 7 award winners. And that happened about 3 months ago. So again, we think that he and his trajectory is only beginning to really, really take off. And you know, we're just so proud of our mayor here, our Mayor James Diossa. And I'm so thankful that he asked me to come back from last year to address this great audience. Martin Luther King Jr. really means a lot to me personally. I grew up as a young person in Boston, Massachusetts. My parents are from the Cape Verde Islands, and I guess some of you might have heard of that. And you know, growing up in Boston, where we grew up in the South End, was a very poor neighborhood with not a whole lot of opportunity for the people that were there. I didn't see a whole lot of homeowners, didn't see a whole lot of professionals, saw a lot of different negative influences, and you know, trying to stay, you know, positive and try to work hard, and my parents always said if you did that, you'd make something of yourself. However, you don't do it on your own. There's always people that are out there to help you. I don't care if it's your teacher, your minister, your parents, grandparents. There's always somebody there that's working on your behalf. So I know we have a lot of young people, so I really want to make sure that you understand that never give up. You always have people behind you at all times. I remember the Civil Rights Movement. I was alive and well when Rosa Parks in 1955 didn't give up her seat and moved to the back of the bus. You know, I was 4 years old when that happened. So I was too young to really be a participant in what was going on in Birmingham. There were 4 men that sat at a lunch counter in Greensboro and refused to move, and they were not supposed to be served because they were of color, and it was like a whites-only counter, and these four young men who were in college were accosted and beat up and arrested and what have you. And even if I wanted to be a part of that, I couldn't because I was only 9 years old when that happened. Now, when the March on Washington happened in 1963, Martin Luther King, I Have a Dream, I would have wanted to be there. I would have wanted to have watched and listened to John Lewis speak that day, somebody that had spoken 3 months ago here in Providence. But again, I was 12 years old, so I was a little bit too young. And I missed that, so here I am, I'm missing everything. Next thing you know, you can laugh. Next thing you know, though, now I'm in high school, and now civil rights, you know, there's more marches, there's more demonstrations. There's the 1964 Civil Rights Act, there's the 1965 Voting Rights Act, there's the 1968 Fair Housing Act, and I'm 16 years old, and I'm an observer of the civil rights movement. But nobody really is truly an observer, because something happened in 1968 that really affected my life to this day. What happened in 1968 is that Martin Luther King, Dr. Martin Luther King, the dreamer, was assassinated on April 4th, 1968. And I never forget the next day being in homeroom and the teacher saying, okay, I want all the students to have a moment of silence. I was in the 11th grade, I was 16 years old, and I just really didn't quite understand what was going on in the United States at the time. All I know is that this country was never going to be the same. For the next month, it was just riots from coast to coast, cities burning, you know, Newark, New Jersey, Detroit, Michigan being two of the most known cases of just mayhem. And I was 16, and I stayed in the house, and I said, I'm not going to participate in any kind of violence. But little did I know, that fall, 1968, as a senior in high school, all of a sudden, as I'm trying to apply to school, I'm thinking about going to Northeastern or Boston State or somewhere else, all of a sudden, schools all over the country are coming to my high school in Roxbury, Massachusetts, recruiting me. And I'm saying, what in the world is going on here? You know, I'm not an athlete. What is happening? What was happening is that the country now was getting into a phase called affirmative action, equal opportunity. And from now on, everybody's going to get a chance to go to the best schools. Everybody's going to get a chance to get some of the best jobs. Up to that point, America was not really living up to its promise of all men and women being created equal. It just wasn't. And some people say, even to this day, it still isn't. At least in 1968, we could be clear that it wasn't. So I had an opportunity to go to two of the best schools in the country over the next 6 years. And that wasn't because my parents marched in any civil rights demonstration. That wasn't because of anything that I did. That was because of people that came before me, like Dr. Martin Luther King and others, who fought, bled, and died so that people like me, 17-year-old kids like me, could have an opportunity to flourish. And the rest is history. The rest is history. So my recollections of Martin Luther King is that if it wasn't for the sacrifices that he made, I wouldn't have had that door open for me and thousands of others like me who are Cape Verdean, African American, Colombian, Puerto Rican, Dominican, to be able to go to schools in the Ivy League, to be able to go to West Point, to be able to go to Stanford. You know, that was the first time. So we were part of the civil rights movement. Those people in the NAACP in Urban Lake says, now you're part of the movement. You will not fail. You will succeed, because if you don't, the kids behind you won't get that chance. So you are going to step up, you're going to go to those schools, you're going to make it, and the rest is going to be history, our glorified history. We're going to make it. We're going to show people that we're as good as anybody. So my thing is, like, don't let anybody tell you what you can't do. Don't let anybody tell you that your dreams are not valid. Don't let anybody steal your dream. Continue to dream, like Dr. Martin Luther King had a dream. And make sure that you respect and honor the people that are around you that are trying to help you. Because that's what they're trying to do, help you. Might not see it now, but you will see it later. And I've been thanking people for my whole life for giving me the opportunities that I have today. And that's all I have to say, because I know we have a great program. I appreciate the opportunity, Mayor, for being here. And I just thank God for Dr. Martin Luther King, and I thank God for all of you. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Next, we would like to invite students from Central Falls High School for a performance.
So this is a small group of students made from a group of 60 students who will be performing on Tuesday. I'm taking this opportunity for our PSA, right? Tuesday at 6 o'clock at the high school auditorium. If you would like to see the larger celebration, we would love to have you come here. And we're giving you a little taste. This is our commercial tonight. So the next two pieces you're going to see, Elisa Guzman is an alumni from the high school. She's come back and worked with us for 14 years now, and she worked with Luden and Natalie at 5 o'clock at night after she got out of work and created this piece. The piece that you'll see after that, alumni Brian Dominguez is here tonight, and he's here with one of the hip-hop dancers. And he has also been volunteering his time throughout his break from CCRI. So we're very grateful for all the alumni support we get at the high school.
Can we get another round of applause for those two? Next, I'd like to invite the students from Tall University up front.
My name is Zedwood, and my mom is good.
My name is Shami, and what defeats me is when other people hit other people.
My name is Vincent, and that what hurt me is a kid bullying on somebody else by the difference.
My name is Captain. One thing that defeats me is when I get mad and I go to my room and I slam the door, I just get ready, just get fresh air outside. Thank you.
Deep in my heart, I do believe we shall overcome. No, I've drawn hands off from what students know. Sometimes we've had tears in our eyes when we joined together to sing it, but we still decided to sing it. We shall overcome. Oh, before this victory's won, some will have to get thrown in jail for more, but we shall overcome. Don't worry about it. Before the victory's won, some of us will lose jobs, but we shall overcome. Before the victory's won, even some will have to face physical death. Physical death is the price that some must pay. To free their children from a permanent psychological death, then nothing shall be more redemptive. We shall overcome.
Yeah. walking home from school on a cold winter day. I took a shortcut through the woods and I lost my way.
It was getting late. I was scared and alone. But then a kind old man took my hand and led me home. Mama couldn't see him, but he was standing there. And I knew in my heart he was the answer to my prayers. Oh, I believe there are angels among us, sent down to us from somewhere up above. They come to you and me in our darkest hours to show us how to live, to teach us how to give, to guide us with the light of love. There's so many faces show up in the strangest places. Messy in our time of need. Oh, I believe there are angels among us, sent down to us from somewhere up above. They come to you and me in our darkest hours, to show us how to live, to teach us how to give, to guide us with the light of love.
When life from troubled times and dragging down on my knees, there's always been someone along covered me. A kind word from a stranger, to send a helping hand, a phone call from a friend, just to say I understand. And ain't it kind of funny, at the dark end of the road, someone lights the way with just a single wave of oh, I believe there are angels among us, sent down to us from somewhere up above. They come to you and me in our darkest hours, to show us how to live, to teach us how to give, to guide us with the light of love, to guide us with the light of love.
In my darkest hours, I like to punch a pillow or cuddle with it.
In my darkest hour, I pet my pet dog.
In my darkest hour, I treasure something that I know from Martin Luther King.
In my darkest hour, I cry.
In my darkest hours, I speak to my sister about my feelings.
In my darkest hour, I try to calm myself down.
In my darkest hour, I play.
In my darkest hour, I talk to my dad.
In my darkest hour, I just go. Even my sister.
In my darkest hour, I'll talk to my mom about it.
Martin Luther King lives in all of us. Martin Luther King lives in all of us. Martin Luther King lives in all of us.
Wonderful job at Toll University. Another round of applause. For you. And ending our performances tonight, youth students would be Blackstone Valley Prep.
Thank you. a job. It is about Martin Luther King, so enjoy.
He wanted peace and love all over this land. He wanted peace and love all over this land. Martin Luther King was a peace-loving man. He wanted peace and love all over this land. He walked for you and me all over this land. He walked for you and me all over this land. Martin Luther King was a great, great man. He walked for you and me all over this land. He died for freedom's cause to save this land. He died for freedom's cause to save this land. Martin Luther King was a brave, brave man. He died for freedom's cause to save this land.
Because we already had our winter concert, but if you ever want to watch them perform, we will be performing again in June at BVP, which is down the street on Broad, or they will be performing around the state as usual. So there you go, Stay Hop, Stay Fit. So we're always all over the state, but thank you again for having us, and this is Blackstone Valley Prep, Presto Strings. One more time.
We just had a series of wonderful, wonderful performances. Can we get a round of applause for the high school students, Kelly University, Blackstone Valley Prep? An absolute amazing job all the way around. Our next speaker has performed at Trinity Rep. He has been on Broadway. He is an acclaimed actor, performer, and teacher. For a rendition of The Drum Major's Instinct, I would like to invite Joe Wilson Jr.
I'm not going to use this mic, I don't think. But watching these children, you know, Mr. Mayor, he had asked me to look at the I Have a Dream speech. And as you all know, that we just celebrated the 50th anniversary of that speech being delivered in D.C. There's a speech that I find also just as moving, and it's called The Drum Major Instinct. And watching these young people, I think this speech reminds us, and as we're in these hallowed halls, of our responsibility to them, to the community, to each other, and what we hope that is said about us at the end of our time on this place called Earth. So I give you The Drum Major Instinct. I know a man, and I just want to talk about him for a minute. And maybe you will discover who I'm talking about as I go down the way, because he was a great one. And he just went about serving. He was born in an obscure village, the child of a poor peasant woman. And then he grew up in still another obscure village where he worked as a carpenter until he was 30 years old. Then for 3 years, he just got on to his feet. He became an itinerant preacher. And then he went about doing some things. Now I'm going to tell y'all something. He didn't have much. He never wrote a book. He never held an office. He never had a family. He never owned a house. He never went to college. He never visited a big city. He never went 200 miles from where he was born. He never did any of the usual things that we would associate with greatness. He had no credentials but himself. When he was 33, the tide of public opinion turned against him. They called him a rabble-rouser. They called him a troublemaker. They said he was an agitator. He practiced civil disobedience. He broke injunctions. And so he was turned over to his enemies. And he went through the mockery of a trial. Now, the irony is that his friends turned him over to them. One of his closest friends denied him. Another one of his friends turned him over to his enemies. And while he was dying, the people who killed him gambled for his clothing, the only possession he had in the world. And when he was dead, he was buried in a borrowed tomb through the pity of a friend. 19 centuries have come and gone. And today he stands as the most influential figure that ever entered human history. All the armies that ever marched, all the navies that ever sailed, all the parliaments that ever sat, all the kings that ever reigned put together have not affected life on this earth like this one solitary man. Now today, I can hear somebody talking about him. Today, his name may be a familiar one. Today, I can hear them saying every now and again that he's the King of Kings. And every now and again, I can hear somebody saying he's the Lord of Lords. Now somewhere else, I can hear somebody saying in Christ, there is no East or West. Now, they go on to talk about him. And in talking about him, they say that there is no north and south, but one great fellowship of love throughout this entire world. Now, I'm going to tell y'all something. This man didn't have anything. He just went through life serving and doing good. This morning or tonight in this chamber, you can be on his right hand and his left hand if you serve. That's the only way in. Every now and then, I guess we all think realistically about that day when we will all become victimized with what is what we call life's final common denominator. That's something we call death. We all think about it. And every now and then I think about my own death. And every now and then I think about my own funeral. And now, I don't think about my funeral in a morbid sense. Every now and then I ask myself the question, what is it that I would want said? What is it that I would want said? And I leave you with this word this morning. If any of you are around when I have to meet my day, I don't want a long funeral. And if you get somebody to deliver the eulogy, tell them not to talk too long. And every now and then I'd wonder what I'd want them to say. Now, I want y'all to tell them not to mention that I have a Nobel Peace Prize. That isn't important. I want you to tell them not to mention that I have 300 or 400 other awards, because that's not important. I don't want y'all to tell them where I went to school. I'd like somebody to mention on that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to give his life serving others. I'd like for somebody to say on that day that Martin Luther King Jr. tried to love somebody. I want you to be able to say on that day that I tried to be on the right side of the war question. I want you to be able to say on that day that I did try to feed the hungry. I want you to be able to say on that day that I did try in my life to clothe those who were naked. I want you to say on that day that I did try in my life to visit those who were in prison. I want you to say on that day that I tried to love and serve humanity. Yes, if you want to say that I was a drum major, Say that I was a drum major for justice. Say that I was a drum major for peace. That I was a drum major for righteousness. And all those other shallow things won't matter. I won't have any money to leave behind. I won't have any fine and luxurious things to leave behind. I just want to leave a committed life behind. And that's all I gotta say. If I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word or a song, if I can show somebody he's traveling wrong, then my life will not be in vain. If I can do my duty as a Christian ought, if I can bring salvation to a world once wrought, if I can spread the message as the master taught, then my living will not be in vain. Yes, Jesus, I want to be on your right hand and your left side, but not for any selfish reason. I want to be on your right and your best side, not in terms of some political kingdom or ambition, but I want to be there in love and in justice and in truth and in commitment to others so we can make this old world a new world. Amen?
Amen.
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 Wow. Impressive. Thank you so much for that. We sincerely appreciate it.
The man wrote it. And that speech, many of those excerpts of that speech were played at his funeral because it was a few months before his assassination, and many people were struck by the level of the prophetic nature of that speech in light of the fact that he was about to be killed.
Thank you again.
Thank you.
Now you may be wondering why we have these boxes up here. I'd like to invite Mario Bueno, the president of Progreso, the director of Progreso Latino, and Bernier Carter to talk about the food drive.
Good evening, everyone. And like most ceremonies at the end, you get the announcement, and we're here to give you the announcement. Since 2010, we've dedicated a food drive in Central Falls and the Blackstone Valley to Martin Luther King. It's called the Martin Luther King Winter Food Drive. We got together along with other food pantries in the vicinity because we felt there was a need, and we have a growing need. There's still a lot of people who are hungry. And how many of you want to aspire to be like Martin Luther King? Raise your hand. It's not easy, but we can do our part. And today you can do your part by donating food, by inviting others to donate food, by getting an organization to donate food, or by volunteering. All those things you can do starting today. Our goal this year, like last year, is to raise 6,000 pounds of food, which will serve hundreds of families. Since 2011, we served how many?
8,758
people. Oh, documented.
Documented.
So we could all make a difference. We have partners here who have contributed every year, organizations to this drive, including the city of Central Falls. I remember when we started, it was Councilman Diossa, not Mayor Diossa. And we really appreciate what you can do to help others in the community, and this is a way to help. So the boxes are here. The campaign is starting, and it ends. When does it end?
March 31st, Cesar Chavez's birthday.
So we will be recognizing another community leader who also struggled in the community for equal rights and justice for all. And one thing that we take from Martin Luther King is that he spoke the truth, and he wasn't afraid to face face all of the difficulties involved with that. And it's a struggle and it takes a lot of courage. So I hope we can take that first step and do that in our lives and what we do every day. So thank you so much, and thank you for contributing to the food drive. And thank you to the organizations that are here.
Hi. I'm Vernia, I run the Central Falls Food Pantry. First of all, I'd like to apologize for the guy in the blue, he belongs to me, running back there, I'm so sorry. We're gonna do something really cool. We're gonna have a flat screen TV that is going to be raffled off. So as your agencies or schools are participating in this, there's going to be a flat screen TV. So you have to look for more information to the City of Central Falls website and to Progreso Latino's website. If I could ask everyone to close their eyes, just close your eyes, and think about a time, and I hope no children in this room can think about this time. Think about a time you were rushing. You didn't have breakfast, you didn't have lunch, you were really hungry. Think about that time. Now open your eyes. We have people that live in Central Falls, the Blackstone Valley community, that do not have enough money to purchase food. People that are working to pay their rent, their mortgage, their electric, their car note. They don't have food. We have students at the high school that they're older. They're not able to get full meals because the parents have to make sure the little ones get. So I say this, and I hope that no one in this room is experiencing this, but if you are, you need to come and see me at Progreso Latino. This food fundraiser really helps support my food pantry. We get 3 donations of money from the Rhode Island Food Bank, Senator Betty Crowley, Representative Gus Silva. That's all the money we get to do turkey baskets, to help with Christmas, and to feed people. I can only give them 2 weeks of food. We have partnerships with BIFCAP, with Salvation Army, where they supplement our families. So I share this with you to let you know there is a need. If you can help contribute. If you don't want to give cans, this is a great opportunity. Lent is coming. Don't buy cigarettes. That money you would purchase for the cigarettes, put it in a jar. Put it on someone's desk. You know, we would love that. We do diapers, formula, depends for seniors. So there's a need in our community, and, you know, I just want to ask you to please help us out. 3 organizations have already kicked off. Blackstone Valley Prep over the Christmas, right before the Christmas break, they raised 500 pounds of food. Seton Academy in Central Falls Catholic School, they raised 1,000 pounds. And Murdoch Webbing raised 200 pounds of food that came to us right before Christmas. That was a big help. So I say nothing is, if you can only get 10 cans at your agency, that's a help. And we really appreciate it. And I can only say, when our mayor was a councilman, when we first kicked this off, he came over, he said, Ernie, how much are we getting? What's the number? What's the number? What's the number? He was reaching out to me on a weekly basis, and he never stopped. He never stopped supporting this. So he supported this before he became mayor. I think before he knew he was going to be mayor. He was always our ambassador, and his thing was, I'll go to the businesses. What do you want me to tell the businesses? What do you need me to do? So it's just wonderful that he's allowing us to kick this off. So I'd like to say thank you again. And
if you'd like to drop our food, I think there'll be boxes here too, right?
Yes.
In City Hall. So, you know, if whenever you think of being able to help, this is a real practical way to do it. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. My God, Joe, you inspired me with that speech even more, and I felt through you I met Dr. Martin Luther King in person. Thank you so much for that. Really appreciate it. As soon as I contacted him, he was excited to come to Central Falls. So welcome to Central Falls, and this will always be your home. Doors will always be open here in Central Falls. And I'm also pleased to announce, a lot of my employees are happy about this announcement, but my administration had a successful meeting with the union representatives. And as of Monday, the city of Central Falls will celebrate Martin Luther King Day by allowing our employees the opportunity to attend many events going out to the state. I, for example, will be attending the Minister Alliance Breakfast at the Rose under Patuxent. I encourage all of my employees to attend celebratory events as well. I would like to conclude today's celebration of life with some inspiration from Dr. King as we prepare for the future of Central Falls. Change does not roll in on the wheels of inevitability, but comes through continuous struggles. And so we will straighten our backs and work for our freedom. Thank you and good night.